Good morning. My topic is hemilymph victim and bilateral decompression for thoracic spinal stenosis. Thoracic spinal stenosis is a slowly progressive and insidious degenerative disease that usually manifests with myelopathy and mostly affects the elderly. Causes of thoracic spinal stenosis are thickened and ossified ligament flow, facet hypertrophy, post-facet formation, thoracic disc herniation, and OPLL. Laminectomy is the most common technique for the treatment of thoracic spinal stenosis. Secondary to posterior ligament hypertrophy, these advantages are post-laminectomy kyphosis, instability, acceleration of spondylic changes, post-laminectomy membrane. To avoid this complication, additional instrumentation should be done. Some problems may be occur when instrumentation is performed. The aim of surgery for thoracic spinal stenosis is to obtain sufficient decompression without causing neural damage and instability. In accordance with this goal, unilateral hemilymphatic and bilateral decompression with preserving the posterior structure prevent destabilization and minimizes the postoperative scar formation, and with a limited surgical dissection decreases blood loss, infection rate, postoperative pain, and hospital stay too. We applied hemilymphatic and bilateral decompression for thoracic spinal stenosis as we do in the cervical and lumbar stenosis. 23 patients underwent hemilymphatic and bilateral decompression for thoracic spinal stenosis. 14 patients were male and 9 were female. The mean age was 61 years. Symptoms of the patient were leg and back pain, gait disturbance, weakness, numbness, and burning in the lower extremity, and urinary incontinence. Spinal stenosis, secondary to hypertrophy of the posterior ligament, was included in the study. Severe anterior compression, such as thoracic disc herniation, osteophytic formation, OPLL, and instability were excluded from the study. Coexisting lumbar and cervical stenosis were operated at the same session. The neurologic status was assessed using modified skull score. Post-operative recovery rate was calculated according to the Washington method. As for surgical technique, the ipsilateral lamina at upper and lower segments were partially removed. Then ipsilateral ligament flown was resected. Then, by medial angulation of the microscope, the base of the spinous process is undercut and the contralateral lamina was partially removed. And then contralateral ligament flown was resected. The lateral extension of the decompression was restricted at the pedicle. Hypertrophied or calcified ligament flown was carefully removed from the dura. Sometimes ligament flown can be attached to the dura. The ossification extends along the superficial layer of the ligament flown. The dural ossification occurs only when ossification of the ligament flown progresses. This is a demonstrative case, 73 years old. You can see here severe spinal cord compression on here and facet hypertrophy. Also, there are L3 and L2 L3 severe canal stenosis. Hemilymphatic and bilateral decompression was performance T7 to T8 and L3F3 segments. You can see here enough decompression, and see here, and this is longer area. Another case, 41 years male, you can see here compression stenosis, you can see here. This is postoperative MRI, you can see here enough decompression. This is another case, 60 years female. You can see here anterior and posterior compression. You can see here facet hypertrophy and posterolateral osteophytic compression. This is postoperative MRI. You can see enough compression. Mean follow-up period was 31 months. 92% of the patients in the lower thoracic region, 4% in upper thoracic region, 4% in the middle thoracic region. The mean perioperative jaw score was 5.9 points, mean postoperative jaw score 9.9 points. The average recovery rate was 83%. In this study, there was no surgical wound infection, no need for blood transfusion, no dural tear and CSF leakage, no neurologic deterioration, and no operation-related instability. 26% of patients were underwent tandem spinal surgery for thoracic and lumbar stenosis. 22% of patients were operated previously for cervicospinal myelopathy. 26% of patients were operated previously for lumbar stenosis. As a result, lumbar spinal stenosis was present in 52%, cervical stenosis was present in 22%. If there is a spinal stenosis in any area, all regions should be screened. In conclusion, hemilymphedema and bilateral decompression is a suitable technique for the patient who have thoracic spinal stenosis, secondary to hypertrophy on the posterior element. Complication rate is less, spinal instability is minimal, and post-lymphedema kyphosis is prevented. Spinospore chest, interspinous and supraspinous ligament are preserved. Contralateral paralateral muscle is preserved. Successful clinical improvement is provided. Success of this technique needs proper patient selection. It is also used for multilevel stenosis. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Kemal. It's not usual that the surgeons do not attempt to make tube-guided surgery for thoracic spinal stenosis. Are you scared of injuring the cord during the tube insertion? Do you think that it is possible during the tube insertion you are pushing the lamina and you can cause some damage to the spinal cord?
I don't use tube. I use Wilms Eckhart.
Wilms Eckhart, yes. Retractor. Ah, okay, you don't use tubes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Well, Richard Fester?
Perhaps I can address that question.
Yeah.
What is that? I don't find
Yeah. Right. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, you also use in cervical spine stenosis. Huh?
Yes.
Do you? Okay. Any questions from the audience? Your conclusion that on the result you have mentioned that we must also look at the thoracic spine if a patient has lumbar and cervical stenosis because we sometimes miss that stenotic levels on the thoracic spine, which is actually causing most of the clinic of the patient. Yeah, it's very nice. Yeah. They have no injury in their service. No, they had no injury. Thank you a lot. We must.